Hi everyone, I'm Younès Rabii. I've been a game dev for the past 5 years, and I'm also a new PhD student in game and AI. And today I'd like to tell you about how simple interactions can give new meanings to generated things, or versus a skull in my garden. Let's delve into the what, why, and how on this project. I'm going to tell you about the way players can attach more meaning to generated things, and it's important for us because it's at the heart of what we like in roguelikes. And I'm going to explore that with you by using the observations I made while designing a roguelike myself. So, what's player interpretation? Well, in the 20th century, people used to play games in what was called console mode, where instead of the fancy new graphics that we have today, they used to represent things on screen with keyboard characters. So, a thing like on the screen that looks like an MP with a slash and a green G later will be interpreted by the player as I'm holding a sword and 5 meters to the right there's a goblin. This step is what I call player interpretation. And player interpretation is actually very important for us roguelike players and game devs because it helps us going from a screenshot of draft threats that looks like someone just mashed by a keyboard to whole stories with drama, with funny moments, with plot twists and everything. And the key to do that is player interpretation on what's happening on screen. And we care a lot about these stories. We love them, they are dear to us, and we love them so much that we made a whole conference about them. So player interpretation is actually very important. You can also see designing a roguelike as shaping player interpretation. Let's see how we can do that a bit. So I'm going to speak about Tea Garden, which is a little roguelike that I started after watching Max Kriminsky talk in Roguelike Celebration last year. It was my attempt to make a gardening roguelike, not just in the theme of the game, but in the way it is played. The gameplay loop is very simple. You can brew tea, and this tea can give you dreams, and in your dreams you can collect, you can see strange flowers which are generated by the game, and you can bring back to the real world the flowers that you liked. And the recipe to create a flower in the game is actually very, very simple. You just take a 6x6 pixel grid, you put some symmetry on it, horizontal symmetry, diagonal symmetry, everything, and you color this pattern with up to 2 colors. Since this is a Pico 8 game, this means that the colors I use are already balanced. They already match well together. So the visuals, they are strange, but sometimes they seem compelling. And some players give meaning to them even though the game doesn't attach one explicitly. For instance, this orange thing is just like an orange thing, but this pink one looks kinda like a butterfly, and the green one looks like a frog face. It's a bit like looking at clouds. Like, approximately 90% of the things you see is junk. It has no perceived meaning whatsoever to any player. But in the last 10%, you can actually see things that appeal to you. And the more you can recognize them, the more you are attached to them. For instance, I'm a pretty fan of this frog face myself. It's round, it's lovable, it's precious to me. And these notions, they are very different from player to player. But they can also be influenced by the game. Here's an example. When I designed the game, I added a new interaction to it. It was picking up something, and since the character has no arms whatsoever, they just put the object on their head. And suddenly, what happened is that things, flowers that had no meaning before, started being seen as hats by the player. Like this orange thing became cowboy hat. And suddenly it became the favorite flower of a player. Interaction can help meaningless visuals becoming something that holds a dear meaning to the player. Another example, because you can pick up things, you can also place them on the ground, and suddenly it gives a player the ability to create arrangement of things, and to see in flowers things that can be arranged. For instance, since letters can form words, the player began to see some flowers as letters, a thing that they did not do before. What happens, I think, it is still my personal theory, is that actually the game creates a language with you, the player, and you play an active role into creating this language, even if you don't, even if you're not conscious about it. For instance, the game tells you that something is pink, and you tell yourself, oh, something that looks like this, it should be, and you fill in the blank yourself. Here it could be a butterfly. But by adding a new interaction, you're actually giving more opportunities to the player to fill in more blanks and give more meaning to what's in the game. For instance, here is something that I can put on my head, well, it must be a hat, or a crown, or a helmet, or something. That means that an interaction in the game can have a lot of impact on player interpretation, and therefore the stories they create together. What's interesting is that it can actually go the other way too. Here's an example. For instance, I know that I can wear a hat in the game, but sometimes I look at things and I see a mask in them, and maybe I'd like to wear them too. But it's not a thing that I can do in the game. But since I'm the developer, I just implemented this functionality because I wanted it. It was organically natural for me. The interpretation I had influenced my desire for new interactions. And what's cool is that, since we saw it before, new interactions can help create new interpretations. It's like a loop that creates more and more meaning into the game. And it means that not only player interpretation has a role into how we give meaning to games, but it also has a role into how we make games, or how we mode games, or how we customize them too. But you must be cautious, because it's very cool to be able to evoke meaningful concepts to a player, and they can be very powerful, but you cannot control them. They can be very positive, like for instance, these flowers that is shaped like the letter T, and it's blue and pink, and which I give myself the meaning of translate activism. And it's very positive and it's very strong, it's embedded in the real world. But I also came across flowers that were like crosses with four branches, and it looked to me like fascist imagery, and it was not something that I'd wanted to be in my game. You have to ask yourself, is it something that you want to put to be able to evoke in your game? And there's no easy solution to prevent that. Also, there's something very, very fearsome with this concept. It can spook the game dev. One day I just wandered into one of my gentry gardens for debugging purposes, and I just came across a skull. My own game spooked myself. Very scary. Well, thank you. Thanks a lot for listening to my talk. If you have any questions or if you'd like to discuss it with me, just reach me out on Twitter. Thank you a lot for being